Dis nou presies daai gedoen. Die ene van my 5 jaar terug gesê het ek gaan geld kry vir staan en
ons is praat agter dit.
Ek is nou
as sy.
Ek het nou gesê.
Ja, maar dan.
The day, a man who knows a bit about retail, a man who shops, right? And the irony of it is that my first MC gig was actually for his company. I was an 18-year-old and they gave me a chance about 14 years ago, so thank you to him. I've had great chats with him, very inspiring man, met him at many of his events. And the topic is future of retail in Africa. Please put your hands together for Wayte Mason, founder and retired CEO of Shoprite.
Is Mr. Mandela a Dutch performer?
on loop from both the west to here. So I stopped him, but he didn't help me any of it. So I thought, let me talk about South Africa first. And oh, by the way, I've got all these newspapers for those of you who wanted to see my speech. That was my speech on Monday. There's 20 economists who said that how it was going to go. It is wrong. This morning's newspaper that I got on the plane. So in fact, my whole speech is buggered because of this business day that had other statistics in it. But let me tell you about ShopRite, how we did it 20 years ago in the mid-90s. Africa was then very underdeveloped to what it is today in some countries. And we followed the route because I come from a background as a politician farmer, officer over son, importable, so we do things very fast, wrong, make mistakes, etc. So I came to the board and I said, listen, guys, this South Africa is a good place, but it's not going to grow too fast. We must look for other areas to develop in. I said that to Mr. Van Zyl this morning, and he just buys farms where you can see them. And Pete Carstens doesn't want to buy farms where you can see them, he just buys gold or diamonds. I'm not sure what he buys later. But I think, let's go into Africa. And I went there, first to get your money out. It was terrible. You would know that you couldn't send money out. So one Sunday morning, I sit on the plane, and who sits next to me? Gerard de Kock, the governor of the Reserve Bank. Sunday morning. This guy must have had, I've never seen so many newspapers in my life, probably 30 types of newspapers, and he was reading like hell. So he was sitting in 1A, I was sitting in 1C next to him. Now the one thing my father taught me, you don't talk to the guy, it's the girl, you may as well, but the man. don't do it. And I knew we had a lot of applications in to send money to Mozambique in those days because the Mozambique government was quite smart. They said you could have this piece of land, but what are you going to do with it? 3 years to do what you say with your banks, and there you go. So we had all these bankers, and you know what merchant bankers is, they can do anything except that they would get done. So I sat next to this at the top and went up, quarter of 25 minutes from Johannesburg. I knocked on his leg and I said, Mr. de Kock, I know it's not a protocol, but I come from Portugal. I only apply 25% of protocol to my lifestyle. I have a problem. I need 300,000 rands to give to the peace park in Maputo, and I will deal with you that if you give me this 300,000 rands to invest in Maputo, or to at least procure the land, and then I will give you back times 10 over the next 2 years about the body shop. So I was at home. Don't I kill it? Actually, I wasn't so bad looking. I mean, work bugging me up like what I'm doing. I was sitting there, and obviously he pulls the rank. He says, you know, I am the governor, and it's not really in my powers to get involved in my business. I said, well, you know, retailers, we have to clean the floor sometimes, all sorts of things. So I thought maybe if you walk past the guy whose job it is, whisper in his ear and just say, okay, I feel sorry for Blue Whitey out there. Yo, Tuesday morning I get a phone call from Standard Bank, Merchant Bank, this bank, that bank. Oh, by the way, you've got your 300,000 rands or whatever the number was. And we got it through. So I said, yeah, thank you very much. Just don't charge me commission because I have a different story to tell you about that one. We went out into Africa and Johan van Gerwende, who sits there, he's actually Dr. van Gerwende, he's actually a qualified doctor. I'm not a qualified doctor, I got it because somebody gave a charity to the Stellenbosch University, so they gave me a doctorate in economics. I actually turned around 20 times where I shouldn't have turned around because I didn't read the papers. I had a look at the crowd. many times. Shut up, I can tell you that you're not supposed to do it. So I can give another 5 options on my list. But Johannes showed you, and I gave the slides, Johannes, your slides, I need them to say maybe they can show people, because he presented a paper to the PMA. It was really terrible to go into Africa because there were mosquitoes, there was no infrastructure. There were very bad hotels, so bad that in a place like Zambia, which was probably the best of the lot, our staff, even 5-6 years after we were there, had to paint my room out every time I got there because it was bad. I think Anglos gave the money to build the first hotel. We stayed in a game lodge park, which was very nice. I played matches with the staff in the evenings, but the mosquitoes were wild. They called them washeries. but we got through that. And then I realized that what does it take to move into Africa? It takes a different mindset. You have to be self-sufficient. So we got caravans. There wasn't hotels. We had caravans, generators, food. We always had good wine. I hope you made train dust was in this. We have high denies because it's the best wine in the country. See that they're not paying me for my speech, so they should speak to them. So that was different in Africa. I want to come back to South Africa now. If you look at the situation in South Africa at the moment, there's a growth rate of under 2%. It varies from newspaper to newspaper. I read an article a speech that I made for the Gardening Club in the R. My wife thinks that it's good I speak to the Gardening Club. They made me fly with my own claim of the terrible wine. But if I look what I said then and what it is today, it's like chalk and cheese in 1 year. So, where are we? What is the challenges in South Africa? And how does it relate to the challenges in Africa? In South Africa, we sit now with an unemployment rate of 25%, 37% if you count the unconventional method, which is actually the correct method, because that is really what's happening there. I think the youth, people under 25% of age is in the 50s or 45s in that region. And what growth rates do we need to get back into that play? Now, in ShopRite, when we did things, there's the marketing guys, they're smart. Yeah, I've got so many pages, so I must find the right one. But South Africans, we always blasé about life. And we actually think that we are much bigger than the rest of the world. So I just looked at where does ShopRite trade. And I always said to them, they always said there's a gap in the market, and I said, are you sure there's a market in that gap? Because if you relate the GDP of the USA at 19.39 trillion, now I was going to write all the laws, I thought I'm not going to get myself in the same point as Jacob Zuma. I went for the trillions. So I'm at 10.43 in 14 and now at 12.23, an increase of 2 trillion in 3 years. Now South Africa, this is dollars by the way, gentlemen. So I'm actually going to give you South African dollars, 349 million US dollars. But then you look at the GDP per capita. America at 52,194, South Africa at 6,118. I think it's only Swaziland, Angola, Namibia, South Africa, Botswana, and Mauritius that is more than $2,000 per capita annual income. And if you go down to the Uganda, I'm actually on the advisory board of that of Uganda. The president just forgets that I live in South Africa, so they normally around and he said, "How's your wife?" And he looked at him and he says, "Compared with what?" So, really, I cannot tell you this, so I changed my whole speech when I read this. That's after the girl bumped it down 40 times. I changed my whole speech and I thought, what is the worst thing in Africa, and or the continent of Africa, and what is the biggest that I can tell you about the continent of Africa? And then ask you people around the table if you want to get more information. The CIA network, I always thought they just murder people, but they're a very smart network of information. All these things, what they do and what they do. I think you must make the decision after I tell you a few breaks in Africa, what we did and what we did wrong. Then it's up to you to work out where you want to be. Because for me to speak about retailing in Africa, if you ask me, do you want to farm in Africa, I may say yes. Do I want to? Why? Why would I say that? You know, in Angola, we used to import eggs from South America. Eggs from South America. Now, all you need to buy from ShopRite these little slug aces, what is that in English? You know, the thing that can catch your egg. Catch all the chickens in the town, put them through a slaughterhouse and pack them in your chickens, or go to the people and say, give us all your eggs and buy one of those machines from those Aussie companies. It'll cost you a fortune, but see if you can photograph the chicken eggs and make sure that they're not rotten. Yeah, so there's an opportunity. 80% of stuff that you sell, produce that you sell, the stuff that we sell in the supermarkets, is value-added packaging, all these cardboard boxes, and in South Africa it's fashionable. I see even ShopRite says they're going to be like Woolworths. So they're going to be better than Woolworths. So you should buy good oranges and leaves. But the majority of people eat fansale wenkies. You know what that is? Beans. I don't even know what it looks like. It's a horrible bean, but it's called fansale beans. I know who this fansale is, but he made these beans. I grew up with sale beans when I started. So there's all these things that needs to be. Hotels work, and rest in Africa hotels, great. Hotels are very far out, it's one single big unit, retailing, you get foreign exchange, you don't have problems with foreign exchange. Automobiles, I'm not sure if they can make them there, but it's all important. But the opportunities in Africa, outside South Africa, is great because the competition factor is low, and the usage of this is not there. Now, if you look at all the economies of Africa, even South Africa, they do very good with primary stuff, be that farming, etc. And we're very good with minerals and all that stuff. But in between, in that manufacturing section, we have to turn the steel into body plates. We send it to Japan to bring back, I think we've got a good export department, but that is the problem with the economy as an honorary doctorate of economics. But that's where the gap is for the whole of the African continent. They don't have a sustainable manufacturing industry. They rely on Angola oil, Nigeria oil, South Africa diamonds, politics, and what else? Then you still have the threat that people don't like to go to places where the infrastructure is not good, mosquitoes are rampant, roads are getting bad up in Gauteng. Cape Town roads are still nice, so you can still buy a good sports car and not fall into a hole. Well, last night, I said, I didn't put a bridge there. So, what now? In South Africa, every guy that walks around says, my land is going to be taken. Now, I don't know if it's true, but I have sympathies for both sides. To be honest with you, I have sympathies for both sides. And I need a hell of a lot of negotiations. A lot of negotiations. I think the president is a good bloke for negotiating. I think he's a fair guy. His brother-in-law, Patrice Motsepe, who's a great entrepreneur, good businessman. And Motsepe's two sisters are married to the president. And I'm with Jeff Rattani, so I think Mr. Motsepe has a good influence, so you people must canvass him to say, hey, you must keep things in perspective to do that. But it won't go away unless people are prepared to look at the whole picture, don't dance and sing and hoi clappers and do such silly things like that. It's something which is a boiling point, and it's very bad for industrial work. It actually runs against our biggest threat. Our biggest threat is the 25 or 30 or 37% of people who don't have jobs. Because if they don't have jobs, no matter how smart you are, and no matter where you think we're going to invest, and it's not just South Africa, it's even worse in Africa in those places. The statistics are just not that good. People burn jobs. They're learning. Not like search to good, but unfortunately, Sorry, my English lets me down. I come from Portugal. We knew the difference between a cat and a dog there, but we could never work out if a cat is or are.
If they don't lend us money, we play with the
farms or anything, then people who haven't got jobs. I mean, it's as simple as that. So you can be as hard as hard as you wish to, as long as you have money. My account for Oakley Bazaar always said the rich man shouldn't live with his money in the same country. But that's where we are. So, I'm giving you lots of things to think about tonight. I hope you're all so good. Market size is important. Africa is important. South Africa is important. You know, I checked through some title deeds. Give you a tip. Sir Richard Burke, here at the end of the 17th century, British guy, under his majesty, the Queen or the King of St. George or whatever, gave away all the land. So I think we have a good case against the British government. Not that I want Prince Charles to preside over me, but I was laughing this morning. I thought, what am I going to tell you about corporate governance in South Africa? In Africa, it's very good. Corporate governance is excellent. But corporate governance is also dampening on business. You must be very careful. I mean, we're now on King 5, or I think, or 4 or 5, I'm not sure, but apart from the Queen, he's the longest living monarch in the world. I guess in 4, 5, 10, I don't know if his children are going to be called George King the Fourth or one. So we have to look at that, and we have to have an entrepreneurial balance in South Africa. Now, take it for real. If I did not go into Africa like playing cards, like I can lose, ShopRite would not have had a single business in Africa. I think my board is not more than half of them into Africa, except for one and a few guys who work in the company. But all my corporate governance guys have not done it. And I'm not saying this, please. I think it's very good. But once it's in excess of what you can work on, you must not go to the worlds of Nigeria or wherever. Then you get sued for any bad thing. So please, just put that into your picture, and even in South Africa. And don't do things like Steinhoff did, or not do. I'm not sure you were careful that people call Marcus Oster a crook, because nobody's proved that he's a crook. He may sue the hell out of you. But what I can tell you is that the boards that I have joined or have not joined, I have not seen too many of my board members, apart from reading that pack of notes, which is all audit committee driven, and all those committees. There are all these other committees which are good. Then the end of the meeting comes quickly when you start talking as the business. So I took in a board appointment with Clover, very well-run company, smart company, and I said, what is your biggest threat? Because I was confident. I said, the biggest threat is the guys who produce milk. Because I think Clover had, and I'm speaking under correction, something like 12,000 or 15,000 farmers that supplied the milk, and there's something like 200 or 150 left. Which shows you that you can't really make, the statistics says you can't really make money from having one cow and a bicycle. So you have to put that into the equation. The South African government must put it in the equation. What actually is an optimum farming that makes it? It's not good giving 1,000 farms away and you satisfy 1,000 people, 2,000 farms, and your production cannot be sustained profitably. So I said, guys, I want to go into see how your milk works. I have experience with dairy farms because I had a small partnership with a guy who had a dairy farm. I think my milk cost me more than singles whiskies. Johnny Blues were cheap compared to the milk I drank from my partnership. Mr. Van Sale makes a fantastic business. I went to look at his business. someone said you can't be done. But it was before my time that it wasn't my time that you did it. But if I read you South Africa ShopRite, that I'm very proud that I was associated with it. People often say that I was did wonders, etc. It's nonsense. That there were lots of guys doing wonders. You just had one policy, you're not allowed to say no until you've waited for 24 hours. Simplistic. But I mean, if you take ShopRite, 40 years in South Africa, 27 years in the rest of Africa, 2,401 corporate stores, 1,996 in Africa, over 1 billion transactions a year, turnover $11.3 billion, trading margin 5.4%, the 94th largest retailer in the world, not in South Africa, or in Africa, in the world, 94th largest retailer. And what made me proud and what drove us? Jobs. I started with just under 1,500 jobs in 8 little stores when we bought it. 146,241 workers 3-4 months ago. 33 distribution centers, 800 trucks. It's a bit of fate over that much for my car if I knew that. And if you just to brag for produce, only you would appreciate that as chairman, you would answer there. I asked Ryan, what do you do for produce? He says, let's see. We sell iceberg lettuce to, we sell enough iceberg lettuce to produce 300 million Big Mac burgers. If you pack the apples we sell next to each other in a row, the line will go around the earth. In the fruit and veg we sell in RSA over here, were to be delivered at once, the line of trucks will be from the Namibian border to Cape Town. We sell enough apples to make 6 bowls of whatever that thing is, cow cow. May not be. What is it, the blockchain? sun and the lunar star, etc. Actually, I made a mistake there, but I had a good deal. And the first day I walked into there, and I said, guys, you people haven't got decent overheads. My office is, I've got one secretary, and my office looks like a second-hand printing works. And you have this fancy offices on one floor. There was just people sitting that had secretaries. You had a fight to get to the boss. Over, they were all sitting in front of them. I wonder why. But then we went in for lunch. There was this canteen, beautiful canteen, with two waiters with white gloves that gave us grapes and asked us what we would eat. And shortbread, we used to maybe get a hamburger, and there were no office hours. Because once you write office hours out, what it is, everybody works those office hours. So don't write it, just leave it. So when these people served me all these grapes, I actually get an eye for them. They're very smart. I eat my little finger up, curled up like this. Because I saw in those movies with Richard Burton and his first wife, all these things of King Arthur and Queen and so on. So I felt like that. And when we had finished the meal, I said, guys, you are all very religious. You've heard of the Last Supper. Yeah. I said, well, you've just had the last lunch in this case. Close it up. So once again, Africa does not have and South Africa does not have the monetary value in rands and cents to actually pay for the luxuries we all used to. You have to be very rich in South Africa to drive fancy motor cars. The CEO salaries in the UK has gone up 27%. The gap widens between rich and poor, because what is happening in everywhere in the world, the people that are supposed to run in this lag behind have not worked hard enough, especially the Brits. So they have to import people to run the business. That's not the end. But that is where we are. So put that in. Technology, everybody loves it. Great technology. Even I have, every year I buy myself the best cell phone, and it's all gold. I don't touch a cell phone which is black, not a day. I come from Portugal, we didn't have cell phone days, we had one of that evening in my desk. But we have to be careful that we don't jump the gun. And I listened to Brett speaking. I actually thought he said, I have a three-letter word to describe you with. I looked at his white shoes. I've also got a pair that my daughter bought it for me. Looked at his jeans, those stovepipes. I can't wear them now anymore because my stomach is too big. I look like the bully beef. Stores. So I was there, Lonnie in his bedroom. you've got there. I could not find one. Except there was a small guy in Los Angeles that had about 18 stores, and he said to me, Mr. Basson, I'm so scared to use this art or to clutter the desk of the people because it loads. I've designed a small little campaign program that I can at least tell the guys, hey, you should stop 410 grand baked beans, which you'll make down the road, you're selling 20 cases a day. That was it. In South Africa, we jumped the gun, and not us. I mean, I was told I was at least 20 reporters, which was true, but not on that specific one. So I got there and said, hey, I'm the oak that knows the most about those things that make the lights. So please, just make sure that what you hear, and what you hear is not stuff which works very well in Sweden, America, wherever it is. Mm-hmm. Another 2 minutes. Okay. I bought one of these Volvo things because I love Porsche, so you would understand the 72, I need a Porsche to wave to my wife. So I bought a Volvo, half electric, half petrol. I thought, now I am really, I'm semi-green, semi-speed. And this thing that actually stopped, you can't crash it, because I drove my Porsche, I fell asleep at 11 o'clock in the morning, with all these bloody Googles, I sleep 3 hours a night. I drove into the shop, so my children said, no, you've got to buy this thing. So I bought it. I first made sure, it's the only one in the country, it's a Lani car. I first made sure they registered as a demo, but then I bought it with 2,000 kilometers for the demo. Harrigans. You can make good shopping centers, and that helps the cultural change in Africa. People like to shop in shopping centers. They don't want to shop in a USAID or whatever, that's why we don't have to do so well with USAIDs in Africa. They want to be where everything happens, there must be an IP. You know, you must wear white shoes for that. But he says the following. He says, you must go where the population goes. Right? It's frightening you see it. The world population is about 7 billion people at the moment, or about a year ago, I don't know. There's a couple of guys who are pushing it. In America, it's 1 billion. It may go slightly up by 2050, by 2100, it will be back to a billion. Europe is a billion. It will go, when I say a billion, slightly more, it will go slightly down to a billion. So don't get growth in America and Europe. America's got Donald Trump. He brings the stuff into his country and he boosts his own economy. My son says he's told 75,455,000 lies. And I said, how do you know that? He says, because there's a Google search which you can do. So I said, let me see it. So the lies that Donald Trump says, he talks like me. It's 25%. My son says, no, he lied. It was 24.68%. I said, does it make a difference? Once again, why numbers? Europe, even. Africa, 1 billion now. 1 billion by 2050, which makes it 2 billion. And 2 billion by 2100, or 21st in the century. That makes, and then Asia will be 4 plus 1, will go to 5. So your ratio is now 1114 for being Asia. The other 50, it will be 112 for Africa and 5 for Asia, because Asia will only get 1, Africa gets 2. And 21st century, 1145. So Africa will move from 1 billion to 4 billion by the end of the century. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I think I've given you the best step of the season. I can't tell you to buy any shares because I don't know that, but don't buy sign of yet. Thank you very much. It was nice to meet you.